Paltrocast.
Matt, how is your day going so far besides having to talk to the elite scum media?
The elite scum media. My day's terrific. I've had a coffee. I started doing laundry. That's as exciting as my Monday's been so far.
Sure. Are you Matt to everybody, or is it like once they get to know you, you're Matthew?
No one ever calls me Matthew. Most people, like my friends, call me Hammer because my last name's Hamilton. So it's like Matt or Hammer.
Hence the Twitter handle, Matt Hammer.
There it is.
Now that explains so much. I was going to try and figure out, like, was that an old hockey nickname?
But yeah.
Nope, it's the last name. So
last name.
You're one of those people who's been working forever, but this is one of the first few roles where we go, that's Matt. That's him doing what he does. When did you find out that you had the Turner and Hooch role?
I found out beginning of October. So I got my first audition. I was shooting out of town, and I was doing a movie in Kelowna, and I first got the sides, and I was like, oh yeah, this is like right up my alley. I get to do comedy. He's kind of like a hero cop, kind of a dick. I'm like, oh, this is fuck yeah, this is awesome. I get to do this. This is so fun. And so I did it. I taped it up there. My friend taped for me. And I was just like, I improvised a little bit of my stuff. I'm like, okay, boom, done. And then, you know, 3 weeks go by, and a friend of mine, he works in the casting office that they do that in. And I was talking one day. He's like, hey, I got to go. We're doing a Turner and Hooch callbacks. And I was like, what? I didn't get a callback? How is that possible? I fucking nailed mine. And he's like, well, let me check. I was like, I thought I crushed that. How did I not do it? And he's like, oh, they haven't done your character yet. They're going to do whatever. So then I get my callback. And we do it was on Zoom, over Zoom, because it was, you know, COVID shit. And so that was it's kind of tricky and weird because you got the phone set up in the middle. And when you're acting, you're doing your stuff, you do your eye lines, you kind of split the screen. But when somebody laughs on their Zoom, the screen like flips over. And so I was doing my audition. And again, they let me kind of improv and stuff because that's what I did in my first one. And, you know, they got... you know, EPs, creators, network people, casting people. So it ended up like the screen kept moving when I was doing my thing, which was kind of distracting, but I guess it worked because I got the role. So that would be, to make a short answer obscenely long that you probably have to cut down.
No. That's intriguing. That's the stuff I like, because most people give like fairy tale answers, like October, and everything is wonderful. And you just explain what it is like to do the audition process in the COVID era. We've always hear about comedians having to do like the Zoom comedy or to a capacity thing to 12 people, and they don't hear the laughs, so it throws them off. It's interesting to hear that you as an actor had a similar situation where you're like, I think it's going well, but you can't like sell it on your face.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So it's a bit strange. Like, and I'm one of those people, I actually enjoy being able to tape auditions. Mm-hmm. I can do it at home, and I know that you're not in the room and stuff, but I kind of like being able to, I want to do one more. Let's try that again. But I do miss like the director producer sessions, like the second, like the callback, where then you can like really know if there's a connection. So when I finished that audition, like I felt, I was like, well, I think I killed that. That's kind of what I do. So if it goes somewhere else, all good. That means they wanted something different. Mm-hmm. I was fortunate enough to book it. So I kind of booked it while they're shooting the pilot. October, early October-ish.
Did it help that you were a Vancouver guy? Because I do realize that a lot of it, or almost all of it, was filmed in Vancouver.
Yeah. I mean, I think all of it was, except for like maybe splinter unit, second unit kind of establishing stuff. It must have, because although I know that the final two were both Canadian, because the guy who went to network with me is a friend of mine. It must have helped in the sense that at that point they were having to fly people up and quarantine them in hotels for 2 weeks. So
sure,
I mean, that's probably not super cheap. I know Disney's not hurting for cash, but I imagine the convenience of just also having actor who lives here. So you don't have to be like, oh, we want to bring him in for this episode, but we can't because he can't quarantine and do all that stuff. So having me local, I'm sure, must have been really beneficial for them.
That's a curious topic for me in general, because it used to be, going back to the olden days of pre-2010, everything was still filming in New York and LA, except for some movies in Toronto and Vancouver.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is, if you want to make it big, you had to move to New York, LA, maybe Toronto. And now more and more actors I'm speaking with, they don't. They go, in fact, I've never filmed a movie in LA. In your case, were most of the productions you were doing, a lot of the TV movies, was that in the Vancouver area as well?
Yeah. Yeah. It's been mostly like I've mostly shot in Vancouver, Toronto, and then a lot of interior British Columbia, like in the Okanagan Valley, which is like wine country, lake country, ski country. So a lot of those kind of like bullshit TV movie things, that's perfect for them. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, I love you. I love you. There's wine and beautiful and looks great.
Yeah. But one of my obsessions with relation to Vancouver is not the hockey. It's the fact that so much heavy metal and hard rock happened because of Vancouver. Because are you a big music guy per se?
I love music. I always like, I listen to music every day. I'm not sure if like I'm as big as you are, given you're wearing a Cheap Trick shirt and it looks like you got fucking records on your wall. So I'd say we're in a different level. Yeah.
Different echelon.
Yeah.
But growing up as a big, you know, rock guy, you find out that a certain percentage of what's played on Canadian radio had to have been made in Canada by Canadian artists. But if there was a Canadian producer like Bob Rock, who did Metallica and Motley Crue and all that, then it was a Canadian artist by default. It'd get played on the radio and it was huge. But Loverboy and Bryan Adams, all these key things were made in Vancouver, yet we think of them as like American.
Yeah, right.
No, it's Vancouver.
Yeah.
So are there any other industries up there besides now television, hockey, and hard rock that are like secretly in Vancouver?
Oh, good question. I know the theater scene in Vancouver is not super great. It's much better in Toronto and obviously New York. It's kind of the pinnacle. But yeah, what else? What else in Vancouver? I mean, it's one of these places. It's like you kind of forget about it because when you live here, you just come and you, this is where you live. You can become used to it, that you forget sometimes that it's like a tourist destination. Like a lot of tourists come here and it's a port city. So come summertime, there's a lot of, I mean, it's beautiful. Like the town is especially, like I live to kind of downtown across from the beach and I'm able to like just get out, go out my front door and I'm on the beach and I can, there's a seawall that goes all the way around Stanley Park. And it's beautiful. So I think maybe that.
I just learned something new. I did not know about the beaches in Vancouver. I'm in a beach town in New York as well. So the secret beach towns of the world. But back to you and back to Turner.
I like that. Yeah, back to me. Enough about you. Back to me.
Had you seen the movie Turner and Hooch extensively before getting this role? Or is it just, you know, once on TV and that was it?
No, I watched it a couple times as a kid because I loved it. And I loved, also loved that one with James Belushi. Canine, which I don't think it held up very well.
It did not, nor did the TV show, but
no. I rewatched the movie and I told the story a couple times, but it's funny because you remember the okay, cool, and the slobbering and him going through the dog door and smashing his head or whatever. And I the one thing I didn't realize when I was younger, I'm like, oh, the movie's kind of dark.
Yes. Cool.
A little dark. And then, they fucking kill the dog at the end of the movie.
Yes.
I couldn't believe that. I was sitting there, I'm watching it. It's on the vet table. And the vet goes to Tom Hanks, no. I'm like, what do you mean no? What the fuck are you talking about? How?
Didn't make it.
How? He's dead? They killed the dog? And it was like, I was like floored. I couldn't believe it. And then they're like, put a bow on it at the end. They're like, oh, he's married with and a kid, and oh, we got another dog, everything's fine. I'm like, yeah, but you still fucking killed, you shot the other dog. What the fuck? But 80s, yeah. Man. Anything went in the 80s.
Yeah, my wife and I watched the first few episodes of your show, of course, research that was needed. Yeah. And the first episode was like PG. It was G. Yeah. It was the darkest G rating ever to maybe like a moderate PG. And then the yeah. second episode, like, not spoiling anything away, but there's like yeah. a gun battle. There's
yeah.
like
yeah, yeah.
adult stuff. There's terrorism. There's references to Die Hard. And it's still yeah. in a tasteful way. But I think that it's very interesting that the team that worked on your show knew how to straddle the line between make it cool for Disney, but also yeah. the adults that might be watching it with the kids.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And I think that was exactly the case. And you know what? I wasn't sure how that was going to go because I wasn't there for the family stuff and all the kids stuff and most of the dog stuff. I just did obviously all the cop shit. And so I wasn't sure how they're going to marry that. And there, I mean, the pilot, there's a lot going on in the pilot.
Yeah.
I think, and I get it. You're trying to like throw everything at it. And then I think as almost every show in its first season, once you kind of get going, you kind of get your footing a bit and you kind of realize where you're at. And I think it's in a really, really good groove now. But yeah, they do. I mean, there's a couple episodes, like I think it's episode, which is the one with the big, is that three? The big shootout at the airport?
We don't want to spoil anything. We don't know if there's an airport or a shootout.
Okay, right. Yeah, exactly. What are we spoiling for? Anyways, that's really, like, that was really cool stuff. It's like, oh, this is kind of a cool shootout.
Yeah.
I mean, if there is a shootout, I wouldn't know.
If there were, it would be interesting and well done. So back to you, the last two quick questions, and then you're free man. The first one is you really keep active on social media every Wednesday with people who want to watch you.
Yeah.
Is that going to continue forever or is that just like a COVID temporary kind of thing?
On social media, like posting stuff every Wednesday?
When I did my research, I saw that you did Instagram Live on Wednesdays, or do I have that totally wrong?
No, I do because the show comes out on Wednesday. So I usually do like a thing and whatever to try and get people to watch it, basically. And I love interacting with fans or I even like interacting with people who aren't fans because I find that quite funny. When someone's like, this guy sucks. I'm like, yep, it's true. I live me. I get it. I'm with you, brother.
And then the last question that I got for you, now that we have established that Turner and Hooch is great and you're on the social media and you're a hockey guy and they call you the Hammer and you're not much of a music guy like I am.
No.
Well, what's next for you besides promoting Turner and Hooch? Any other things to plug or coming up?
I was in a movie that came out last night, but I don't know. It's already out. So, I don't know. Like I got a couple writing things in development that one of them would be really cool. It's a crime thriller I wrote. So I'd love to do that, but we're still in the process of trying to angle cast. So nothing there yet. I shot a couple things that will come out in the next, to be honest, I don't know. So I can't really promote that either, but yeah, I mean, IMDb is the best way to kind of find what, if I'm doing something, if it's coming up or my Instagram.
Makes sense to me. We'll follow you on social media and we'll know the latest and the greatest, but thank you for your time, Matt, and really looking forward to what's next, whether you wrote it, acted in it, or wrote and acted, can't speak today, wrote and acted into it, in it.
Yeah.
In it.
Yeah. Easy for you to say. Paltrocast.